Hello everyone, I'm Nikita Lakhani and today I'll be representing LexClick and I'll be speaking on the topic Mitakshara Coparcenary in Hindu law. So beginning with its basic meaning, the Mitakshara Coparcenary is a smaller group within the Hindu joint family. The members of the group by virtue of relationship have a right to hold and to enjoy the property to restrain the act of others and also to enforce partition. Now we'll go through its basic characteristics. The first one being, what is the status of coparcenary? They are the people of the Mitakshara coparcenary who acquire a right to partake of the inheritance. Their right arises by birth and according to main, it goes on for 3 generations next to the owner. Now, the son of the great grandson is not a coparcenary so long as the common ancestor, the prepositus, is alive. Now, when fresh links are being continually added to the chain of descendants by birth, earlier links are being constantly detached or removed by death. Hence, the membership of the coparcenary may be increasing or diminishing. The second thing we should know about is survivorship. There is a community of interest and unity of possession among all the members of the coparcenary, which was clearly laid down in Katama Nachayar versus Raja of Shivaganga. Now, on the death of the coparcenary, the others take by survivorship. The words of Lord Westbury in Approvier versus Ramasubbayanan are classic. No individual member of the family, while it remains undivided, can predicate that that particular member has a certain definite share of the joint and undivided property. Now, the Hindu Women's Right to Property Act 1937 made an inroad into the coparcenary and provided that on the death of the coparcenary, his interest devolved on his widow. The Succession Act 1956 has, by declaring that the widow becomes the absolute owner of the property, Section 14, abolished limited estate. Now, the third thing we should be clear on is about the partition. How does it take place? Each member of the coparcenary has a right to claim partition. Without the partition, a member cannot predicate his share in the joint family property. The property will be fluctuating, the quantum of it in the share will be diminishing by birth and increasing by death, as we discussed earlier. Now we'll be speaking about heritage. What role does it play in Mitakshara coparcenary? So heritage is divided into two classes. Apratibandhadaya and Sapratibandhadaya, which means unobstructed property and obstructed property. According to Mitakshara, the wealth of a father becomes the property of his son, son's son, and son's son, and this is unobstructed property. Property which develops on parents or on brothers and collaterals on the death of the owner is obstructed property. Now, what is the position of women? Women are not members of the coparcenary. The twin principles of the right by birth and apratibandhadaya make it evident that women were kept outside the coparcenary. Now, what is the son's right? A son as a coparcenet takes his grandfather's property and father's property on the principle of right by birth and apratibandhadaya. Smriti Chandrika makes it clear that in case of grandfather's property, the ownership and independent power of the son and father are equal, but in the property of the father, the ownership of father and son are unequal. I hope that was clear. The right of the son remains dormant and enables him to succeed by survivorship or by apratibandhadaya. This was clearly affirmed in Arunachala versus Muruganatha in 1953 by the Supreme Court of India. Now we'll be discussing about the changes made by Act of 1956, the Hindu Succession Act. So the two major changes that were made were in the following aspects. The co-partners may by will or any testamentary document dispose of his undivided interest in the co-partnery, which is according to Section 6. Now, as we discussed earlier about the survivorship, what changes were made? The rule relating to the survivorship in a Mitakshara co-partnery is kept intact, but some changes have been made in provision of Section 6. Now we'll discuss that change. So if the Mitakshara co-partner has died leaving a female heir or relative that is class 1 heir, or a male in that class who claims through such female, the interest of the male in the co-partner property devolves by intestate succession and not by survivorship. That is, the female gets the property by succession, hence no survivorship. Now we could discuss the role of the Karta. So as the head of the family, Karta is absolutely in management of the co-partnery. He is a sui generis. He may alienate the property if for legal necessity. Now we will be talking about Hindu Succession Act Amendment 2005. So this has made drastic changes in Section 6 to the Mitakshara co-partnery after its commencement in a joint family governed by Mitakshara law. The daughter of co-partner shall by birth become a co-partner, have the same rights in the co-partnery property, be subject to the same liabilities in the respect of the said co-partnery property. And any reference to the Hindu Mitakshara co-partnery shall be deemed to include the reference of the daughter of a co-partner. Exceptions that are those partitions or dispositions of property before the commencement of this act are considered valid. Now the female Hindu becomes entitled to dispose of by her testamentary disposition. Her interest devolves by testamentary or intestate succession and not by survivorship, and the co-partnery property shall be deemed to have been divided as if a partition has taken place. Further, the daughter is allotted the same share as is allotted to the son. The share of the predeceased son or the predeceased daughter, as they would have got if they would have been alive at the time of the partition, shall be allotted to the surviving child of such predeceased son or such predeceased daughter. Now we'll be speaking about joint Hindu family. So this consists of all the persons who are the descendants of a common ancestor. A joint and undivided status is the normal position of a Hindu family. The status as a member is by birth. The Hindu undivided family may consist of single male member and widows of deceased male members. Now that we are through and know what a joint Hindu family is, we'll be talking about the two kinds of property. So the first one being ancestral property and the second is self-acquired property. So ancestral property, it is a property of a male Hindu in which the son and son's son acquire an interest by birth. There is unobstructed line of heritage called as a pratibandh daya. The property devolves by survivorship and not by succession. Accretion to ancestral property and all purchases made or profits earned from the income or sales are ancestral property. Property inherited from mother or maternal grandfather or collateral is not ancestral. Share allotted on partition. A co-partner's share after partition is ancestral as regards his male descendants only. Now, a property obtained by gift or under a will from the paternal ancestor. This was answered by Supreme Court in Arunachal Mudaliar versus Muruganatha as a separate property. So basically, A had three sons, B, C, D. Under his will, A gave certain properties to his wife and other relatives, and then in the schedule gave his separate properties P1, P2, P3, and to A, B, and C respectively, which they may enjoy absolutely. Held, this was not ancestral in the hands of B, C, D. It is their separate property. Now, what is doctrine of blending? Property thrown into common stock of the family is ancestral property. Even separate property becomes Hindu undivided property when it is thrown into the hodgepodge with intention to abandon all rights over it. Continuing with the discussion of the Hindu Succession Amendment Act 2005, we'll be discussing what shall the daughter of the co-partner get. By birth, they become a co-partner in her own right in the same manner as the son, have the same rights in the co-partnery property as she would have had if she had been a son, be subject to the same liabilities. Now, the only exception here is the partitions or disposition of property before the commencement of this act are considered valid. Now, further, survivorship and the co-partnery property shall be deemed to have been divided as if the partition had taken place. So, the daughter is allotted the same share as is allotted to a son. The share of the predeceased son and the predeceased daughter, as they would have got had they been alive at the time of partition, shall be allotted to the surviving child of such predeceased son or of such predeceased daughter. Now we'll be discussing separate property. This property is acquired by a co-partner without detriment to ancestral property. This is also self-acquired property. The modes of acquiring are as follows: Sapratibandhdaya by obstructed heritage, a gift or grant, separate earnings of a co-partner, income of separate earnings and purchases made therefrom, or business earnings. Fifth one being separate business. Business running in the name of members of the family. One or more members can start a business like partnership business or acquire properties without the assistance of the joint family property. Such business is separate. But if the business is thrown in a hodgepodge voluntarily, then it becomes a joint family property. So, in the case of Bhagwan Dayal versus Rathi Devi, the Supreme Court held that co-partnery is a creature of Hindu law and it cannot be erated by agreement. It is corporate body or a family unit. Properties can be acquired and disposed of. Hence, the position is that one co-partner may carry on the separate partnership business. In the present case, the uncle A and two nephews B and C did not belong to the same branch. Hence, it cannot become a joint family property. Now, in the Madeva Prasad versus Commissioner of Income Tax, manager of Hindu undivided family entered into a partnership as representing his family, of which he was the karta for the benefit of the family. There was a dispute in the respect of the properties of the joint family being involved in partnership business. The court held that the allowances received by the Madeva Prasad directly related to the investment made by the family. Hence, it was Hindu undivided family property and not a separate property. Now, the gains of learning all properties acquired by a co-partner by his own exertion and those coming within the Gains of Learning Act 1930 are separate properties. Now, the sixth one is share. A share or partition in a separate property if the person has no male issues. The seventh one being under the doctrine of blending, separate property becomes Hindu undivided property when it is thrown onto the hotchpot intention to abandon all rights over it, which was clearly stated in Malleshappa versus Malappa. Now we're through this topic. Thank you.